In this video, I'll talk about data prepossessing.
The first type is frequent data, which can be structured or unstructured. With structured frequent data, a record contains a fixed number of attributes and can be stored in flat files or relational databases, in which attributes can be from multiple joined tables. With unstructured record data, a record contains a different number of attributes and can be in the format of XML or JSON data, etc. Transaction data is a special type of record data in which each transaction involves a set of items, such as the items a customer buys within a transaction. A data matrix is a special type of record data which contains a fixed set of numeric attributes and can be represented by an M by N matrix, with M rows for M objects and N columns for N attributes. Document data is another special type in which each record is a document and each attribute is a term. Attribute values are actually the counts of the corresponding terms in the corresponding document. The second type is graph-based data. We consider two cases: data with relationships among objects and data with relationship with objects that are graphs. With data with relationships among objects, web pages, which contain both text and links to other pages, can be an example. The data objects are mapped to the node, and the relationship between objects are captured by the links between objects and also link properties such as position and width. Web pages can be described using directed graph, while social networks can be described using both related graph and unrelated graph. Data with objects that are graph, in this case, molecular structures, is an example. The last type is order data. First, we talked about sequential data, which is a sequence of transactions. As an example, the second type is sequence data, which is similar as above with no timestamp, and the example is DNA sequences. With temporal data, the example is stock prices, and with video data, the example are sequences of images in this video. A data set can be viewed as a collection of data objects. Data objects are also known as tuples, records, points, vectors, cases, samples, examples, entities, or instances. Here are some examples of data objects. In HuskyCD system, instructors and classes can be considered as data objects. In Husky Hire system, jobs and applicants can be considered as data objects. Data objects are characterized by attributes that provide information about properties of attributes. So for example, in PeopleSoft system, attributes are class number, course number, or course name, number of enrollments, room number, and building number. Now let's talk about attributes. An attribute is a data field that represents a characteristic or property of a data object. Attributes are known as variables, fields, features, dimensions, etc. The values of an attribute can be numbers or symbols. Attribute types can be nominal or categorical, ordinal or interval or ratio. With nominal attribute type, also called categorical, the only operation is distinctness. Let's look at some examples. The ID attribute is or contains a set of net IDs. You can compare net IDs, for example, to see if the two net IDs are the same or different. You cannot say a net ID is greater or less than another. Another example is iColor, which is a set of colors, black, blue, and brown. You can compare two colors to see if they are the same or different. You cannot say a color is greater than or less than the other, or any other operations like addition or multiplication. Other examples are zip codes, states, and etc. With ordinal attribute type, the operations can be distinctness and order. Let's look at this example. Grade is a set of A plus, A, A minus, B plus, B, B minus, and C plus. You can compare two grades to see if one is greater than or less than or the same or different from the other. Another example is height, in which you can apply the operations such as distinctness and also order. Tall has higher order than medium, and medium has higher order than short. Similarly with size, small has lower order than medium, and medium has a lower order than large. Some other examples are like months, January, February, March. Months are in order, or this of food. With the interval attribute type, there are three operations you can use. Including distinctness, order, addition. The examples are calendar days or temperatures in Celsius or Fahrenheit. With ratio attribute type, all the operations can be applied, including distinctness, order, addition, and multiplication. Examples are temperatures in Kelvin or length, time, and counts. Attributes can be discrete or continuous. A discrete attribute has only a finite or countably infinite set of attributes, infinite set of values. Examples are zip codes, counts, or set of words in a collection of nothings, and often represented as integer variables. Binary attributes are special case of discrete attributes. A continuous attribute had real numbers as attribute values. Examples are temperature, height, or weight. Practically, real values can only be measured and represented using a finite number of digits. Continuous attributes are typically represented as floating point variables.
Data are normally stored in several forms. For example, a relational database with Oracle, MySQL, Microsoft SQL Server, etc. Large-size datasets are normally stored in NoSQL databases. So NoSQL stands for not only SQL, and they are non-relational and more efficient. As examples such as Dynamo, FoundationDB, MemcacheDB, etc. Small datasets are normally found in spreadsheets and flat files.
Thank you. themselves in. Steps in data mining, data cleaning, deal with filling in missing values, smoothing out noise, identifying outliers, and correcting inconsistencies. Data integration deals with combining data from multiple sources, detecting conflicts from multiple sources, etc. Data transformation deals with putting data into the suitable form for data mining. Data reduction techniques include techniques such as data aggregation, attribute subset selection, dimensionality reduction, numerosity reduction, and discretization. Data reduction is used to obtain a reduced representation of data, improve the performance of the algorithms, and note that the categories are not mutually exclusive. First, let's talk about data cleaning. Data cleaning deals with handling missing values. Missing values can be due to system malfunction, or deleted due to misunderstanding, or not collected at the time of data collection. For example, people declined to give their age and weight when filling the forms, and may not be applicable to all cases. For example, annual income is not applicable to children. Data cleaning also deals with smoothing noisy data and duplicate data, which is a major issue when merging data from heterogeneous sources. For example, the same person may have multiple email addresses. How can missing value be handled? You can ignore the whole record with missing values, or fill in the missing values manually, or use a global constant to fill in missing values. Constants are like null, unknown, etc. Or use the attribute value mean to fill missing values. Or you use mode for categorical attributes to fill in. Or use attribute mean for all samples belonging to the same class to fill in the missing value. Or use mode for categorical attributes. Another method is to use the most probable value to fill in the missing value. And in this case, Bayesian classification or decision trees can be used to predict the missing values. How can noisy data can be smoothened? One of the common methods is the binning method. For example, they accept values, including 4, 8, 6, 15, 21, 21, 24, 25, 28, and 34. The first step is to partition into equal frequency bins, and then either smoothing by bin means or median, or smoothing by bin boundaries. Other more sophisticated methods are regression, which fits data to a function, and clustering, in which points fall outside cluster are considered.
Outliers.
Data integration combines data from multiple sources into a coherent store. The first problem is the entity identification problem. So, when you combine data from multiple sources, how can you or your algorithm be sure a customer ID field in source A be the same or different from a customer number in source B? Another problem is the redundancy problem. An attribute is considered redundant if it can be derived from others. For example, total amount with and without tax. Redundancies can be identified using correlation analysis. Correlation between two categorical attributes can be discovered using the chi-square test. Redundancy at the tuple level should be considered as well, in which the same record can come from multiple sources. The next important issue is detecting and resolving data value conflicts. Attribute values from different sources in real-world applications may be different. Total sale from source A may indicate total sales of a branch, while the total sale from source B may indicate the total sale of the region. And similarly, room size from source A may be in square feet, and room size in source B can be in square meters. Data transformation. Data transformation transforms attribute data into suitable forms for data mining. First, we talked about smoothing. Smoothing is used to remove noise from data. It is a form of data cleaning and was discussed before. In data aggregation, summary operations are applied to data, and it is a form of data reduction and will be discussed later in data reduction. Discretization and concept hierarchy generation. Here, low-level data are replaced by high-level data, and it is a form of data reduction and will be discussed later in data reduction. In normalization, attribute values are scaled into a small range of values. There are many methods. Here we discussed three methods. Min-max normalization, z-score normalization, or also called standardization, and normalization by decimal scaling. In attribute creation, new attributes are constructed from the given ones. Normalization maps attribute values to the new ones. Transformation in general uses many functions, including simple functions with normalization. Attribute values are mapped into specified small range or intervals of values. The first method we discuss here is decimal scaling, in which attribute values are scaled or divided by 10 to the k, with the smallest k such that the maximum of the absolute value of the attribute values less than 1. Another method is called min-max normalization, in which the mean is subtracted from the attribute values and then divided by the difference between the max and the mean. The last method is called z-score normalization. In this method, the mean is subtracted from the attribute values and then divided by the standard deviation. Attribute creation creates new attributes that can capture the important information in the data.
Z-score normalization or standardization. Z-score normalization, or we also call it standardization. The variable is subtracted by the mean and divided by the standard deviation to create a new variable.
Attribute creation creates new attributes that can capture the important information in the dataset much more efficiently than the original attributes.
Easy score normalization, or also called standardization. The mean is subtracted from the variable and then divided by the standard deviation.
Attribute creation creates new attributes that can capture the important information in the dataset much more efficiently than the original attributes. There are three general methodologies. With feature extraction, this method is domain specific, and techniques in one field may not be applicable to other fields. For example, techniques in image processing is not applicable for using in other fields. The second is mapping data to new space. So here you may use transformations such as Fourier transformation, wavelet transformation, or principal component analysis, independent component analysis, etc. to transform data into a new space that may reveal more information for data mining. With feature construction, features are combined to create new features. For example, density. Density can be created from mass and volume to classify materials. Data reduction techniques are used to reduce the representation of data sets and make data mining more efficient. Data reduction includes such strategies as the following. Data cubed aggregation, in which aggregation operations are used to reduce the number of attributes. Numerosity reduction, such as sampling, clustering, etc., in which data are replaced or estimated by alternative, smaller data representations, such as parametric models or non-parametric methods, such as clustering, sampling, and the use of histograms. Dimensionality reduction, in which encoding mechanisms are used to reduce the data set size. Attribute subset selection, in which irrelevant, weakly relevant, and redundant attributes may be detected and removed. And finally, discretization and concept hierarchy generation, in which the raw data values for attributes are replaced by ranges or higher conceptual levels. Data cubed aggregation uses aggregation operations to reduce the number of attributes. Let's consider the case of a sales dataset. The dataset contains the sales data quarterly from year 2002 to the year 2004. The data can be aggregated to provide the yearly sales from 2002 to 2004. Aggregation operations are provided by data cube. Here we discussed the data cube concept with sales data. In which each cell holds the data value, which is corresponding to a data point in a multidimensional space, including item type, branch, and year. Branches can be grouped into regions and that help to summarize data quickly. Now let's talk about numerosity reduction with sampling. The key principle for effective sampling is using a sample will work almost as well as using the entire data sets if the sample is representative. A sample is representative if it has approximately the same property as the original set of data. With simple random sampling, there is an equal probability of selecting any particular item. In sampling without replacement, as each item is selected, it is removed from the population. In sampling with replacement, objects are not removed from the population as they are selected from the sample. The same object can be picked up more than once. In stratified sampling, data is split into several partitions or strata, and then samples are randomly drawn from each partition. In the simplest approach, an equal number of objects are drawn from groups, regardless of group size. In variations, the number of objects is proportional with the group size. Data mining algorithms perform better if the number of dimensions is lower. Dimensionality reduction helps reduce the amount of time and memory required by data mining algorithms and allows data to be more easily visualized and may help to eliminate irrelevant features or reduce noise. Techniques for dimensionality reduction include principal component analysis, singular value decomposition, as well as other techniques such as supervised and nonlinear techniques. Let's investigate the principal component analysis. The goal of this method is to find a projection that captures the largest amount of variation in data. Here we need to find the eigenvectors of the covariance matrix, and then use the eigenvectors to define the new space, and then project the data onto the new space. Now, given a d-dimensional dataset with n data points, we want to project the dataset to a new space to maximize the variance of the projected data. First, let's consider a unit vector u1. This data vector is projected to a scalar value. This is the variance of the projected value. And it can be derived into U1 transpose A, U1. And A here is the covariance matrix, in which X bar is the mean vector. Here we maximize the projected variance. With respect to U1, under the constraint that the length of U1 is equal to 1. Here, a Lagrange multiplier lambda 1 is introduced. This is the objective function that we have to maximize. This is the variance of the predicted value, and the other one is the constraint with the lambda 1 introduced. Taking the derivative of this and let it equal to 0, we get to another form and another form. This is actually the variance of the predicted data. And on the right side, it is lambda 1. So here we say projecting data to an eigenvector with largest eigenvalue maximizes the variance of the projected data. In general, eigenvectors can be obtained from decomposing the covariance matrix, and then a smaller set of normalized eigenvectors with largest eigenvalues can be selected as the principal component analysis transformed. In general, eigenvectors can be obtained from decomposing the covariance matrix, and then a smaller set of normalized eigenvectors with largest eigenvalues can be selected as the principal component analysis transformed. Here, the number of eigenvectors are small or much smaller than the number of dimensions in the original dataset. Then, the projection XPCA in the PCA domain can be expressed as the dot product of the transform, which is formed by using the normalized eigenvectors and the original vector X. And you can see the number of dimensions is reduced to facilitate the computation. If the number of dimensions is very large, that may cause the out of memory. You can create a covariance matrix, an N by N covariance matrix, instead of the D by D covariance matrix. Then compute the eigenvalue lambda I prime and eigenvectors U I prime, and from there, compute the eigenvalues lambda I and eigenvectors ui following the formulas. This is an application example using 30 stocks in the Dow Jones market. If the number of dimensions is selected as 2, the graph shows the original stock price signal as well as the pre-constructed stock price signals. And you can see the signals are pretty much following each other. Even the number of dimensions was selected just 2 and very small. Attribute subset selection is another strategy to reduce data dimension. Redundant attributes are the ones that duplicate much or all of the information contained in one or more other attributes. For example, the purchase price of a product and the amount of sales next paid. Irrelevant attributes are the ones that contain no information that is useful for the data mining task. For example, student ID is often considered irrelevant for predicting student's GPA. Discretization and binarization. Many data mining algorithms require discrete attributes to work efficiently. Discretization is to reduce the number of values by grouping them in a number of intervals or bins. Discretization can be supervised, meaning class labels are used, or unsupervised, without class labels. Binarization is to create attributes with values of 0 and 1. First, we talked about supervised discretization. Entropy-based approaches are one of the most promising approaches for discretization. First, let's define entropy. Entropy of the ith interval, ei, is a sum from 1 to k of pij, log of pij. K here is the number of class labels. Pij is probability of class j in the ith interval. If in the ith interval there are only values of class j, then Pij is equal to discretization. First, let's define entropy. Entropy of the ith interval, ei, is a sum from 1 to k of Pij, log of Pij. K here is the number of class labels. Pij is probability of class j in the ith interval. If in the ith interval there are only values of class j, then Pij is equal to 1. That leads to the entropy of the ith interval is equal to 0, which is Huygens' purity. Intuitively, the entropy of an interval is measure of the purity of the interval. The total entropy is a weighted average of the individual interval entropies. In unsupervised discretization, class labels are not used. The equal width binning approach divides the range of attribute values into intervals of the same width. As you can see in this illustration, there are four equal intervals. Another approach is equal frequency binning. Discretization and binarization. Many data mining algorithms require discrete attributes to work efficiently. Discretization is to reduce the number of values by grouping them in a number of intervals or bins. Discretization can be supervised, meaning class labels are used, or unsupervised, without class labels. Binarization is to create attributes with values of 0 and 1. First, we talked about supervised discretization. Entropy-based approaches are one of the most promising approaches for discretization and binarization. Many data mining algorithms require discrete attributes to work efficiently. Discretization is to reduce the number of values by grouping them in a number of intervals or bins. Discretization can be supervised, meaning class labels are used, or unsupervised, without class labels. Binarization is to create attributes with values of 0 and 1. First, we talked about supervised discretization. Entropy-based approaches are one of the most promising approaches for discretization. First, let's define entropy. Entropy of the ith interval, ei, is a sum from 1 to k of pij, log of pij. K here is the number of class labels. Pij is probability of class j in the ith interval. If in the ith interval there are only values of class j, then Pij is equal to 1. That leads to the entropy of the ith interval is equal to 0, which is Huygens' purity. Intuitively, the entropy of an interval is a measure of the purity of the interval. The total entropy is a weighted average of the individual interval entropies. In unsupervised discretization, glass labels are not used. The equal width meaning approach divides the range of attribute values into intervals of the same width. As you can see in this illustration, there are four equal intervals. Another approach is equal frequency meaning, which divides the range into m intervals. Each interval contains approximately the same number of observations. Another approach is k-means clustering, which partitions observations into k clusters, in which each observation belongs to the cluster with the nearest mean. Linearization is to create attributes with values of 0 or 1. The first thing is to list the values, all the categorical values, then uniquely assign each value to an integer in the interval from 0 to m minus 1. And m is the number of values. Then each value is converted into a binary number. In the first example, three attributes x1, x2, and x3 are used to code five values, five categorical values. This method may cause unnecessary correlation. Another better way to do this is to use five binary attributes. Each is for one of the values.